So I have one and a half hours time, and I have still like 1.5 talks, lectures to give. So I have to skip some of the material, which is partly your fault, because you have been so active asking so many questions that it has been slow. But I think that's really good. So just, I mean, keep on asking questions. It's more important to go slowly, properly through some material than just, you know, skim through everything in a fast way. So what I'll do is to still say something about these heterogeneous space movement models, these diffusion, advection, reaction models in particular, after which I move to a completely different topic, which is the evolutionary aspects of movement or dispersal. So as you might remember, I was talking about these kind of models where you can assume that, you know, movement rate, diffusion, but also advection, the tendency to go to some direction, mortality, habitat selection, they might depend on the structure of the landscape. So what I'll do next is just to show you very briefly that these kind of models are nice in the sense that they are mathematically convenient. There is a lot of mathematical theory, some of which actually Luca was talking in the last lecture. So far we've been mainly looking at the probability density. This is like a general domain. This omega, this is like your confined space in this case. It might consist of several habitat types, like omega 1 is maybe patch, omega 2 maybe a matrix. There might be habitat selection at the boundary. You start from the position y, maybe you are presently here at the position x. You may have different kinds of boundaries, like here this B is reflecting boundary, C is absorbing boundary. Here we have a kind of a hole inside the domain, this is also absorbing boundary. So we can look at probability density. You start from here, then you run the model for until some time, and then you ask what's this distribution of locations where you might be. You can look at also occupancy times. You can draw any kind of subset here, like this capital X. You can ask that if I start from here, I run the model until some time, until infinite time. So until I hit either this absorbing boundary, the process stops, or until I die. How much time altogether did I spend in this region? This is the occupancy time, the mean time that I spent here. Actually, the first passage time is a special case of this. That's what you get if you say that this subset X is the whole domain, how much time you spent altogether before you hit the boundary. You can look at hitting probabilities. If I start from anywhere in the domain, what's the probability that I will, let's say, hit this part of the absorbing boundary before I hit some other part of the absorbing boundary or I die? You can look at the conditional process. If I know that I start from here, that and eventually this process will end so that I let's say hit this part of the absorbing boundary, so before dying, what's the probability density of my location in some mean time? Or we can look at quasi-stationary distributions. If I just move so long that it doesn't anymore matter where I started from, where I'm likely to be, what's the probability density for the location? So for all of these kind of quantities, and then there is a longer list than just this one, there are like mathematical theory from which you can calculate these. It's kind of based on adjoint operators. We have this operator L, which describes, you know, how the probability density evolves in time. You can take the adjoint operator, which is pretty much changing this plus into a minus and changing some order of differentiation. So this comes out when you do kind of integration by parts. I'm not going to through this. Just mention briefly that, you know, where these mathematical tools come from. And with the help of these, like, we have a theorem that how do we figure out this hitting probability. With the help of that theorem, we can solve this problem that, you know, if you start anywhere from the landscape, what's the probability that you will hit this particular patch before you die. This is what I showed already. And I think this is rather useful because, you know, you can use these quantities as measures of functional connectivity, like predict movement rates between habitat patches. And you can also use them to look at kind of scenario simulations, if you like. For example, in this case study, this butterfly lives in certain kinds of grasslands, and it's a conservation issue because there is habitat loss fragmentation. It occurs mainly through vegetation overgrowth. So this is a hypothetical scenario of habitat loss. Some of the habitat patches, these red ones, they might disappear. So after habitat loss, you have like less, smaller patches than here. And maybe some of these sub-habitat, semi-open forests, maybe the forest just grows and it becomes closed forest, which is not anymore even suboptimal habitat for the species. So if you want to understand the influence of habitat fragmentation to population dynamics, one step is to understand how habitat fragmentation influences movements. Okay? So we can make predictions of this type. Assume that we apply this kind of habitat loss, and then we are interested to know how much the probability that you move, for example, to this focal patch in the center, how much that changes due to habitat loss. So what is shown in this graph is not like the absolute movement probability, but the ratio of movement probabilities after habitat loss compared to before habitat loss. So basically what this color is showing that after habitat loss, these butterflies are moving more, because you see just red color, no blue color here. So the movement, the probability that you get to this patch from any initial location is greater in this case than in that case. Basically, because you know there is, this relates to this corridor example that I showed. There is less interesting stuff for the butterflies in the landscape, so they move faster. You can also, I mean, if you work in the context of state Bayesian framework, so that you have a posterior distribution for your parameters, you can also look at kind of the confidence bounds for this kind of predictions. For example, this is the lower bound, 2.5% quantile for this prediction, which is showing that, I mean, only a couple of areas you have blue color appearing, so that we can be highly confident that this is indeed the case, that habitat loss is actually increasing movements rather than decreasing them. Okay, and then just to illustrate these other quantities that you can derive from diffusion models, this is just a kind of an arbitrary example. It's a real island of with some habitat patches. Let's assume that there is a wind pushing you to some direction, so we have an advection term. I have plugged here a barrier which is kind of making movements more difficult. Then we have these habitat patches and the matrix. Here I just simulated some movement tracks. There I again illustrate a hitting probability. But let me now illustrate other kind of quantities. So in this panel we start from a certain source patch, and I'm just showing how the probability density evolves over time. Okay? So you start from here, then the probability starts to spread, and this is what you get at kind of infinite time. This is the quasi-stationary distribution. So you see that in this case the butterfly is most likely to be in this corner of the island. And why is that the case? It's the case because I assume that there is a wind pushing to that direction, so that's why it's eventually more likely to be in this corner.
What, so the different lines represent different starting points, or because all this refers to a given start point, no?
The starting point is the same in all of these. So this is the fundamental solution. I start from here and then I just see what happens. But like the last one, this is actually a conditional process. So I say that I start from here at time zero, but then I know that I end up to this other patch here, this target patch at time two. Let's say that we observe the butterfly here at time zero and here at time two. We don't know where it was in between, but we want to make some inference about that. So this is like the conditional probability density. So that after, just after time zero, this is what we think where the butterfly is. And then at time 1.8, this is where we think the butterfly is, and eventually it homes to that patch. So at time 2 we know it for certain because we observed it there. So this is called the Brownian bridge. We are kind of, we know where we were. sometime and sometime later, and then we fill in the intermediate locations.
Why do you call it the quasi-stationary distribution? Isn't it steady, the stationary distribution?
Yeah, that's a good question. So if we don't have mortality, and if we don't have absorbing boundaries, then it's the stationary distribution. But if you have absorbing boundaries or mortality, then you know eventually the butterfly will die, so that the probability density goes to zero. So quasi-stationary distribution is the stationary distribution conditional on not being dead yet. Okay, there are also some other things illustrated here, but let me skip those. And I mean, these are illustrations of those occupancy times. I'll skip them as well to have time to talk about something else. And what I next wanted to say is that in simple geometries, you don't need to do only numerical solutions, but you can do analytical solutions. So this example is actually closely related to what Luca was presenting here. I'm just doing analytical results for the case of a circular habitat patch. So assume that you have here a patch which is of radius r, and it consists of whatever habitat type. It has its own movement rate. The movement rate here in the matrix, all the rest is matrix. This is like infinite space, it's not confined space. The movement rate in the matrix is some other parameter. And then you have some habitat selection parameter here at the edge, and then you can have mortality parameters which might differ between patch and matrix. You can ask about immigration. If you are initially at some distance s here, some distance s from the habitat patch, what's the probability that you will ever visit this place, okay, before you die? Once again, in a 2D case, if there is no mortality, you will hit that with probability 1. So this question is more meaningful only if there is some mortality. And that's really easy to solve. The result looks like this. These k zeros, they are Bessel functions. This is just an illustration of how that result looks like graphically. So in the y-axis, we have the hitting probability. In the x-axis, we have the size of the patch. So obviously, if the patch gets bigger, it's more likely that you will find it. And also, if you, the further you are away from the patch initially, the less likely you are to find it. Okay? We can ask about emigration. What's the probability that if you are initially in this patch, you will emigrate and ever reach some distance s from that habitat patch? I didn't write the analytical expression here, but I mean, it's not much more complex than this one. It's showing that emigration probability decreases with patch radius, because in a big patch, you are less likely, you know, to hit the edge. And when that's only the only case when you have a chance of going out. And it also depends heavily on this habitat selection, strength of edge-mediated behavior. So that if there is a very strong habitat selection that you like to stay within the patch, then of course you are less likely to emigrate and go out. In contrary, this immigration probability, that doesn't depend on habitat selection, because I'm just asking that what's the probability that I will ever, you know, hit the edge of the patch. And then you can ask about these occupancy times. What's the time t that an individual which is currently inside this habitat patch is expected to spend there before it dies or reaches some distance s from the patch? Obviously, that time that you spend in the patch increases with patch radius, because in a big patch the emigration probability is lower, and it also increases with the strength of this habitat selection, because that's the thing that's keeping you in the patch. So if I let the habitat selection parameter go to infinity, it becomes a reflecting boundary. And then this mean time that you spent in the time is your expected lifetime. You can also do analytical results for this kind of landscape, where you have circular patches in an surrounded by uniform matrix. So what I'm illustrating here is is such a case, I mean, this is a symmetric case. This path in which we are to start with, it's in the center, and then we have these four kind of target paths in a symmetric setting. P is the first hitting probability. That's the probability that if I start from here, I will visit this patch before I visit any of the other patches and before I die. Okay? I have an analytical expression. I'll just show what the expression looks like. So it looks pretty horrible. I mean, this is the analytical expression. I'm not going to actually tell how you derive it, but this is, it's a kind of a combination of Bessel functions and matrix algebra, but there is an analytical expression from which you can calculate these probabilities. So the probability that I'll get here is like 0.11. And this, of course, the same for all patches because this is symmetric. These t's, they tell how much time I'm going to spend in any of those patches, but let's not go to that.
The area is confined. Is there borders around?
No, it's an infinite landscape. Okay. I just draw this box around it. Yeah. Okay, to make this bit more interesting, let's make it unsymmetric by having exactly the same setting that I had before, but I just added three more habitat patches, this which I denote by orange color so that you can see what are the new patches that I added. And let's see what happened to these hitting probabilities of these original patches that were there to start from. So here the hitting probability is 0.11 for this patch, but in that landscape it's 0.075. So it's a little bit smaller. And why is that the case?
Because you have more time to spend in the other patches, no?
It hits another patch before it hits this patch.
Exactly, that's the correct explanation. This is the probability that you will hit that patch before you hit any of the other patches. Okay, now the patches I added, they are kind of competing for the migrant. Let's look at these two patches here. This is like, I mean, in this case, originally their hitting probabilities were of course the same because it's symmetric, 0.11. Now it is 0.03 for this and 0.04 for this one. So the hitting probability for this patch decreased more than for that patch. And why is that the case? Of course, because I added a bigger patch in between than to that side, so it's kind of competing more. If you look at this patch here, if we compare this one and that one, they are kind of otherwise in a symmetric situation if you forget about this, which is kind of behind it. And what you see is that the hitting probability for this one is smaller, a little bit smaller than for that one. So this patch, that's the influence of this patch here. I mean, it might have been that the individual would have moved like this and kind of come from that direction to this focal patch. So this patch now captured the individual from its way. This is just the first hitting probability. Then you can ask about the total hitting probability. What's the probability that you eventually visit that patch? Okay.
But isn't that one? If you don't have mortality?
Yeah, if you don't have mortality, then they all will be one. In this case, we have mortality. I mean, this is like done with some parameter values that are relevant for a butterfly. So what I show here is the sum of all of those first hitting probabilities. That's the probability that you will make a successful migration move. So 1 minus that is the probability that you'll die before you migrate to any of the other patches. So that, of course, increases if you add more patches. Okay, well, why is this useful? I mean, this analytical formula, they look pretty bad, but still I think they are very useful because it's much, much easier to implement these into your computer program than, let's say, solve this diffusion equation numerically. I mean, you can solve these kind of things in a fraction of a second. You don't need to do any complicated finite element methods. You know what is the solution, okay? So that's what we have often done is, like in this case, we have this island where we have habitat patches. We approximate them by circles with the same areas, with the same spatial locations. we forget about the boundary, like in this case it's natural to assume that, I mean this is an island in the middle of the sea, it's natural to assume that there's reflecting boundary because the butterflies, they don't go to the sea, but we forget about that because that's what we have to do.
If there is wind, it could be absorbing a boundary. If they are carried by the wind, it simply dies there.
Yeah, yeah, that could be the case. I mean, it's not the case here, but could be the case. These butterflies, they are not much influenced by wind, because if it's windy, they don't fly, they hide in the vegetation. So, if we make the approximation that, you know, instead of the real shapes, we use circles, but with the same total area, we assume that the patches are kind of small compared to the distances between them. That was a hidden assumption in my derivation. It's not really the case here. And then as I said, we forget about this reflecting boundary condition. If we do all of that, then we can apply the analytical formula. And what you see here is like a comparison of how bad is the approximation. So what would these, for example, hidden probabilities be in the real case based on the numerical solution, and what they are based on the analytical solution. So in many cases, and you know, in some cases these matches are simply perfect, because if the landscape is highly fragmented, then you know it's not anymore an approximation. We know that this is the exact result. So in practice these work pretty well.
So the worst assumption here is the boundaries?
Not really. I mean, here there's maybe no time to go in detail through this, but like L1 is the result for the original landscape, L2 is the result otherwise for the original landscape, but we just get rid of the reflecting boundary. Okay, here we have L1, here we have L2. So you see that, you know, it's not very bad. I mean, this line is not the fit, it's the identity line. So it's bad only for some patches, like 9 and 10. If I go back to the previous slide, okay, 9 and 10 are here, they are very close to the boundary and they are close to this kind of a bay, so that's a difficult situation, but for the others, doesn't really matter much. Okay. Okay, let me skip the rest of this so I have time to... No, let me do the conclusions before I move to the final lecture. So, conclusions. Variation in habitat quality can be modeled either by classifying the landscape into a finite number of habitat types, or by assuming continuous variation in habitat quality. I've shown examples of both approaches. I'm certain there are still further ways to do that, but these are like two major approaches you can take. And after you have classified your habitat into discrete types, or thought what kind of covariate, like whatever altitude, might influence movements, you have to decide how it influences movements. So any aspect of these movement models, diffusion, advection, mortality, distribution of step lengths, turning angles, so on, you can assume that any of those depend on spatial location or time or whatever covariates you have. So you of course you cannot do like all alternatives and ask which out of these fits your data best. You have to make some kind of biologically motivated hypothesis. So this is often the most difficult part of modeling, which is something that, you know, just a modeler, just a mathematician or statistician can't do, because here you need the biological knowledge to know, you know, what are your hypotheses, what you actually want to test, what you expect. So, in some sense, diffusion is just a random walk. It's like, you know, a model of a stupid animal. It's just, you know, moving randomly. But still, I think if you build in features into diffusion models, diffusion, advection, reaction models, you have still rather simple and mathematical tractable class of models of animal movement, but, you know, a set of models that make some sense in heterogeneous space. You can build in a lot of biological behaviors into simple models. All right, any questions on this before I talk a bit about evolution of dispersal? So, coming back to the very first lecture in this course given by Ran, he made the point that you know, why organisms move is one part of course of the movement ecology framework. And you know, maybe especially with animals, you can sometimes think about why, what's the motivation to move, even without any evolutionary considerations. But especially if you work with plants, whatever, fungi, this is a really almost a meaningless question if you don't think of the evolutionary aspects, which is of course also the case for animals. I mean, eventually why they move is because of evolutionary trade-offs. So I wanted to talk a little bit about how you can model this why part. This is something that doesn't relate on data. This is like a theoretical model now. Just this mathematical approach that, you know, let's make assumptions and see what happens. If you are going to model something like evolution of dispersal, I think you need to take a model where you couple ecological and evolutionary dynamics. So such models are called like eco-evolutionary models, and they are becoming, I think, increasingly popular. So that, I mean, in the earlier times you tended to have like separate models for evolution and for ecological dynamics because, you know, people thought that the time scales are so much separated that there is no point putting them together. But in the past 10-20 years, people have realized that that's not actually the case, that often the time scales are not so separated that you might think of. And you really have to couple these two. So there is quite a big and especially increasing literature on these kind of models. I just listed here a couple of our recent papers that do this eco-evolutionary modeling. What I will talk for the rest of this lecture is just about this one paper, which is about evolutionary responses of dispersal distance to landscape structure and habitat loss. So, let me try to represent this model graphically with the help of pictures. There are some equations here, but it's basically, I try to do it with just graphically. So the key here is that, again, we want to look at what happens in a heterogeneous landscape. So we have some distribution of resources that the species needs for its reproduction, survival. And I assume that those resources are distributed like shown here. So they are distributed as kind of habitat patches. So the darker is the green color in these figures, the higher is the habitat quality locally. So this model, thanks. This model takes place in continuous space and continuous time. So we have here these habitat patches. These black dots, they don't denote the centers of those resource patches. Okay, they are just like points. I have plotted them with some dimension, but they are just points. And then I assume that there is some kind of a kernel that describes how the resources are distributed around that center of the habitat patch. The key here is that you can control the structure of the habitat or landscape. So that in all of these four panels, the total amount of resources that you have, that's the same. So it's constant. But then the spatial distribution of those resources is quite different in these four panels. So we can either have like many small patches or then a few large patches. Or we can have, you know, many patches of low quality or a smaller number of patches of high quality. All of those scenarios lead to the same total amount of resources. Note that if we have like two patch centers close to each other, then we simply add up the amount of resources kind of in both habitat patches. So in one corner we can get to kind of a highly fragmented landscape that we have small high quality patches surrounded by unsuitable matrix. So this is where you would expect to see metapopulation dynamics. Then in one corner of this continuum where we have very large patches but they are of low quality, so that they are quite, you know, there are many, we just end up with homogeneous space. Okay, so we kind of have a continuum from homogeneous space to a metapopulation-like situation, and then we have these intermediate cases where we have continuous variation in habitat quality. This landscape can also be dynamic, meaning that those patches, they may disappear and new patches can appear. Okay, it can be either static or dynamic. And on top of this kind of a landscape, we place a species. So we assume that the species is utilizing these resources and trying to survive in this landscape. In this simple model, I'm not assuming a feedback between the kind of the resource and the consumer. So this is not a resource consumer model. If there is an individual utilizing that habitat patch, it doesn't have an influence on habitat quality. So this is more, let's say, that these are the habitat patches for the butterfly and they have so much resources that the butterflies can't deplete them. Okay, so then we plug in this population. Now the individual, this is a model of discrete individuals. It's not like a population level model, but it's an individual based model. All these red and blue dots, they are the individuals. And this is a model for kind of a sessile organisms, let's say for plants, so that they are not moving around, they are just where they are, and all the movement happens at the reproduction state. So what these individuals are doing is that they produce seeds at some rate, fecundity rate F. Whenever I produce a seed, I kind of throw it away, and it lands into the landscape according to some dispersal kernel. Okay? We can assume, for example, a Gaussian dispersal kernel, but because we want to do evolution, we assume that there is variation within the population. That's why we have here the blue individuals and the red individuals. Blue individuals are the individuals which have a short-range dispersal kernel in this case. Red individuals have a long-range dispersal kernel. But otherwise, these individuals are identical. They produce seeds at the same rate. The only difference is that how far do they throw them.
Difference in the shape of the distribution of the dispersal kernel or in the parameters?
You can do either of these. In this case, I'm assuming that the shape is the same, for example, Gaussian, but then the mean is different. But we repeated this exercise also for the case where the kernel becomes more leptokurtic, and actually that gives the same results as what I'm going to show. Okay. In this graph, these black dots, they are the centers of the habitat patches, so they kind of determine the distribution of the green value. Mathematically, these green contour lines, that you get that if you think that those habitat patches are Dirac delta distributions and then you convolve them with the patch kernel. What these individuals are doing is to producing seeds at some fecundity rate F. Those seeds are dispersed, then they have an establishment rate, probability E, and then these individuals which are VAB established, they have a death rate D. Okay? And I need to put some density dependence into this model, either I will get just exponential growth. So I'm assuming that density dependence is operating through the death rate, so that if you are in a high density situation, then you have a higher death rate than an individual in a low density situation. But density, you need to measure locally. So it's like the density around you. And that's what's illustrated by these contour lines. They are like the isoclines of local density. If you look at this red individual here, it is in the valley of these contour lines. Because it's isolated from all the other individuals. It has a low local density. There is a small circle around it that's generated by itself. Okay. So the real valley is here where there are no individuals. But anyway, this individual is experiencing a low density and it will live long. Whereas here we have an aggregate of individuals, so they are on the kind of the top of these contour lines. There's a high local density, and that's why the death rate is high. What you see here is actually one realization of the model. I mean, I've simulated it in a much bigger landscape, and then just looked what happens. Taken a snapshot from a situation in the center. So what you see here is that those individuals, they are mostly distributed where the resources are. Okay, this is what you would expect, because the I think I didn't say it here, but in this case I assume that the landscape quality influences fecundity. So the greener the color, the more seeds you produce per time unit, and that makes the individuals aggregate to where the habitat is. But then there is this counteracting force that creates a high density of individuals, and then they have a high mortality rate. So that produces kind of self-thinning of the population.
Two questions. First, the size of the local density, the radius you check around it, with respect maybe to the dispersal distance, is highly influential. For instance, if the size of the circle you are counting individuals in for this red individual would have been exactly where the two neighbors would have fit, so it would actually suffer from higher density. And another question I had is about the, you assume that the resources affect, they do not affect mortality, they only affect fecundity, and the density doesn't affect fecundity, it only affects mortality. And actually both countering effect could have been very prominent in many cases.
Yeah, very, very good point. Just to make a little bit small correction here, so here this isolated individual is not surrounded by neighbors. These two are kind of black dots, so they are habitat patches. Okay, but I mean you are right that the spatial scale of competition will influence what we see here. I didn't tell where these contour lines come from, but I assume that there is a competition kernel. Okay, something that decays with distance. If you want to know what's the local density at any given location, then it's a sum over all the individuals in the infinite landscape weighted by that function that decreases with distance. And the scale of that function is one critical parameter of this model, sure. I mean, for the sake of illustration, I saw this kind of discrete variation in qualities, but everything is smooth in the real underlying model. Your second point was very good, that, you know, it is true that we have made some special choices. Density dependence influences death rate, okay? It could also influence fecundity establishment. And we have assumed that landscape quality influences fecundity. Okay, it could also influence mortality, establishment, or then it could influence density dependence. It could influence carrying capacity. So actually here we have even in this very simple modeling framework, we have four choices to make here, three choices to make here. So we have 12 different models. And actually in that paper, we did all those models. Okay. And the result that I'm going to show was actually very robust, so that you got the same answer in all models, which then led us to think that okay, there is something more general about this result than if it would be different in all of these cases. Then you could do combinations of those, but I don't think you want to do that, because if you see that like these extremes give the same result, then combinations should as well.
Doesn't that contradict what you ended your last lecture with, that you have to choose your parameters, according to your sensible biological hypotheses, rather than do a brute force approach test all models?
Yeah, that was for a little bit different context. What I'm doing here is evolutionary theory, okay? So the aim is not, this is not something that you use for data analysis. This is, to understand the link from the assumptions to the consequences, okay? Maybe I didn't say it, but the biological question that I'm really trying to ask is that how does the structure of a landscape influence, movement behavior that evolves in that landscape? In this case, I've simplified movement behavior just to what is the scale of, dispersal kernel that evolves in the landscape. This is my question, okay? And in this case, I think you don't want to just address that by one model. Because, you know, if, let's say that the answer is very different, depends on what model you pick. Then this theoretical, you know, answer that you get is actually very context dependent. You have to say that, well, it depends on this, that, or not. But if you have tried many different, kind of structurally different assumptions, then you are more certain that, okay, it's likely to make some general sense, and this, you know, makes sense to like compare that prediction to data in a qualitative manner for different kinds of organisms.
So maybe that the previous statement applies more to hypothesis testing and statistical modeling. Right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if you analyze your data with these state-based models, you don't want to run 250 different models. You just want to pick the ones that are, you know, biologically interesting for that case. Of course, you know, even I do these 12 models. They all belong to the same family. I mean, I could try very different kinds of models, like whatever discrete, you know, population level models, or, you know, very different types of, structurally different types of models, but you can't do everything. So just one word or couple of slides about the kind of the mathematical aspects with these kind of models. If you are a statistician, you would call this model as a marked point process. If you are a mathematician, like Yuri Kondratiev, you call this as Markov evolutions in the space of locally finite configurations. And if you are a mathematical biologist like Ben Volcker, then you usually write down a spatial moment equation for these kind of models. Yeah, this summer I spent almost 2 months in Germany. We organized with Yuri and Ben and some others a research program on mathematical biology. Quite much to look at the mathematical aspects of these kind of models. And, you know, there was some discussion that for biologists it's difficult to, you know, sometimes understand mathematical terminology. But it also goes vice versa. Like, this guy here, I mean, he's really interested in biology. That's why we organized this seminar. But he's a mathematician, not even applied, but, you know, proving theorems. So on. So after like 3 weeks of, you know, heavy discussion, he was finally ready to kind of understand our model, and he wanted to explain it in our words, like the I was considered as the biologist, not the mathematician there. So then he was explaining the model, like really trying hard. So we have these particles, which are the animals, right? And then these animals, they produce seeds, right? I think I have to write the introduction to that paper. Okay. You can simulate these kind of models, but you can also do mathematical analysis. You can figure out what's the mean field model. Actually, in these models that I described verbally here, the mean field model is the logistic model of population growth. The mean field model means that the scale of interactions, you assume that's very, very large, so that there are no any more like spatial or local aspects. Then you just get to a differential equation, which is that of logistic growth in this case, for all of those 12 models that I described. But once you do that, you have got rid of all space and also stochasticity that you have. This is an individual-based model, so there's like demographic stochasticity is included. So that model doesn't anymore tell you anything about, let's say, evolution of dispersal. So you have to do something bit more. And what you can do is to look at what happens around that mean field model when the range of interactions is still quite large, but it's finite. Okay, that's something that you can do analytically. This method we developed with Steve Cornell is kind of a perturbation expansion around the mean field model. But the more important thing that I wanted to talk to you is that how can you think of evolution in these kind of models? And there are at least 2 ways of doing this. Oh, here we have Ace North, who was my PhD student, doing much of this work. So you can either use an evolutionary stable strategy, ESS approach. if you are interested in the deep details of this ESS, you should ask Luca. He's the real expert in ESS approaches. The other approach is something that we call the evolutionary stable frequency distribution. So if you do ESS, then you assume that there is always a monomorphic population, which means that all individuals consist of the same type. This is your resident population. You kind of run that population to the stationary state, okay? And then you assume that there is one mutant that appears into this landscape. One of the residents turns into a mutant. In this case, it will have a different dispersal distance than all the other ones. And then you ask if that mutant is able to invade the population, so if it will increase or decrease. If it decreases, it dies. It didn't invade. If it increases, then eventually it replaces the resident population. And then after a long time, everybody has this new mutant type. Okay, then that's your resident. Then you introduce another mutant and so on. This is what you do in adaptive dynamics. So you are separating the ecological and evolutionary timescales. So this is not really an you don't couple them, you decouple them. Whereas in the other case, which is maybe biologically more realistic, but mathematically a bit more complex, you assume that there is all the time a polymorphic population, like I had in this graph here. At the same time, I have the red and the blue individuals. And that polymorphism is maintained because there is a balance between mutation, selection, drift, all the forces of, you know, ecological and evolutionary dynamics. Let me illustrate how this might look like in the context of the model of evolution of dispersal. So what we have here is something which is called the PIP, or pairwise invisibility plot. How many of you have actually, you know, seen a PIP plot before? Okay, so what we have here in the x-axis is the trait of the resident. So in this model, this is the mean dispersal distance of the resident, okay? From 0.5 to 1.5 spatial units in this case. What we have in the y-axis is the mean dispersal distance of the mutant, okay? Let's take this scenario here where we have the red dot. So we assume that the resident has a mean dispersal distance of 0.5, and then we introduce a mutant which has a mean dispersal distance of 1. We ask if it can invade or not. So in this graph, red color means that the invasion exponent is positive, so it can invade. Blue color means that the invasion exponent is negative, so it cannot invade. So this graph here is claiming that that individual, that mutant, will eventually replace the resident population. This is what happens in a model simulation. In the x-axis we have time. In the y-axis we have number of individuals. This is in a log scale. So a straight line means exponential growth. Let's first look at just one realization of the simulation. So the green color is the resident population. So in this simulation, we had something like 20,000 residents in the stationary state. Then we introduced a single mutant. So it's at value 1. Then quite rapidly, this mutant, I mean, it has a positive invasion exponent. It managed to increase to something like 100 individuals, and then we have this little bit slower phase of growth in the logarithmic scale. And eventually it replaces the resident population, so the resident starts to go down because they are competing. There is some carrying capacity. This is what happens for, you know, one successful invasion. But if I repeat this simulation like 10,000 times, I will see that even for this kind of a mutant with a positive invasion exponent, most, you know, attempts to invade will actually fail, because you start just from one individual, so it has a high chance of, you know, dying before it takes off. if you take the average of all those invasion attempts, I mean those that failed and those that didn't fail, you will get this red line here. So this is the increase of the mutant population average over realizations. First you have this phase of exponential growth on average, and then you get to some kind of a carrying capacity. This black line here is the analytical prediction. So it's the analytical prediction which is kind of the value of the contour line here. So this analytical prediction is something that we derive from that perturbation theory.
There is some dependency in the size of the population, because if, for instance, your population, take it to extreme, was 3 individuals and you introduce 1 mutant, it really has higher chances. And if your individual, the population is 100 mutants, so it really depends on the parameter of the population size, no?
Yeah, you are right. What I didn't maybe say is that we assume an infinitely large landscape. So in the theoretical model, to which, for example, this prediction is based on, we always have infinitely many individuals.
Then you don't have risk if you
are. So what is finite, you know, is population density, the number of individuals per unit area. And you have genetic drift in that case because it's a spatial population. So if you look at any finite region where, you know, this population individuals really interact, in that one you have a finite number, you have drift. Okay, if you take this kind of a situation, so that the prediction is that the mutant cannot invade, this is what happens on average, that, you know, it really dies off. None of the invasions was successful. Okay, let's then have a look at this PIP plot more closely. What I have here in the center is ESS, evolutionary stable strategy. It means that this strategy of the resident, like this value of something like 0.9, if the resident has this dispersal distance of 0.9, there is no mutant that can invade the population. Because if I look at in this direction, I only have blue color. Okay, that's why it's an evolutionary stable strategy. If I would start, let's say, with the resident with the higher dispersal distance than the ESS, there would be a range of mutants that could invade me. And eventually the process takes you here. I mean, there is a lot of terminology in the field of adaptive dynamics. That place is an ESS because nobody else can invade you, but it's also CSS. It's a convergence stable strategy because you will get there eventually. So there are strategies which are ESS but not CSS, but in this case they are the same. Okay. These lower graphs, they show the other approach of modeling evolution, where you assume that you have this polymorphic population. So you have some mutation between the two types, kind of continuously. Or let's say that you have your heritability is not one. There is some chance that you produce offspring which are not identical to you. So what happens in those kind of landscapes is that you get the distribution of dispersal distances at the stationary state. So when you just run the model long enough, the distribution of the different types that you have in the system, I mean, you don't need necessarily have just two types, but you can have a continuum of dispersal distances. There is some distribution of those which typically peak somewhere close near the ESS. And like how, what is the, like the deviation around the ESS depends very much on the level of heritability. So if you assume like heritability 1, then you will converge to the ESS. If you assume lower values of heritability, like here, then you can have very wide distribution. Okay, this was the modeling approach. Finally, I want to go back to the biological question and ask how landscape structure, but also life history of the species, influence the evolution of dispersal. What's the time? How much time I still have?
45 minutes.
Okay, more than I expected. Start asking questions, otherwise I run out of material. Let's first ask this question here.
Any question?
Yeah, any question.
Okay.
You have to ask.
Yeah, afterwards.
Afterwards. So, let's first look at this kind of variation in habitat structure, where we keep the total amount of resource is constant, but just the spatial configuration is different. And then let's ask that what kind of dispersal distances we expect to evolve in, you know, more continuous landscapes, homogeneous landscapes, or more patchy landscapes. How does patch size, patch quality influence that? I will stand here so that you don't see the result. So
you shouldn't warn what you shouldn't.
So I mean, make a guess. What do you think? What kind of dispersal distances evolve in those kind of situations? Like in what kind of landscapes you would expect that long dispersal distances evolve? The more heterogeneous leads to which case? So that like here you would have large dispersal distances, or which way you think? Okay, so here you would have large distances, and when you get here, you would have smaller or even larger, smaller.
The more homogeneous it grows.
Okay.
It also depends on the difference in quality.
We have opposing predictions, which means that, you know, this modeling exercise was not useless because we can ask the model. Yeah, that's a good point. So there's a cost of dispersal in these kind of situations, that if you move far away, then you are more likely to end up into the matrix, the unsuitable habitat, and you can't reproduce there. This is one clear, you know, part of the traits of dispersing or not dispersing in a heterogeneous landscape. Remember that in this model we don't have any trade-off. I mean, often in reality, individuals that are very dispersive, they might be less fecund than individuals which are more sedentary. Here we don't have the case. So there's no cost. You can, if you like, you can disperse to the, you know, whatever distance without any cost.
But there is a cost. There is a cost of missed opportunities, because if you are in a patch in lower upper left corner and you have a given fecundity F and you spread the seeds all over the place, so you missed the higher chances of fecundity at this specific place. So there is a cost, even though there is no trade-off with the seed size and seed number, there is a cost, because you could have done better if all seeds were in the specific place of the higher quality.
Exactly. I mean, this is basically what you said. You said the same point, that there is this implicit cost that if you disperse far away, then you are less likely to end up in the good habitat. So that's the reason of not to disperse. But what's the reason to disperse? Exactly, that's the reason why you would like to disperse. That if you don't disperse, then you just build up this very high local density. I mean, maybe it's better to go to some place which is maybe a little bit less in terms of quality, but there is nobody else. Okay? And especially, I mean, you are escaping competition, but especially you are escaping keen competition. So it's more important to be further away from your kin, like parents, sisters, because you don't like to compete with them. Because if you are far away, also your kin are doing better and they carry the same genes. Okay. So you want to escape competition, and in particular kin competition. So what happens in this corner of the parameter space if I go, you know, even further to the limit where we have just a homogeneous landscape? What should happen in a homogeneous landscape?
No, it shouldn't affect.
A very large distance, as far away from the kin as possible.
There is no trade-off. There is no price for
dispersing.
For long dispersing.
Yes, you just want to be as far away from the kin as possible, because there is no cost for the long dispersing.
I think we have two schools. Some of you want to be as, you don't want to disperse, you want to disperse as far as possible. One of these answers is correct. It's either like infinite dispersal or no dispersal.
There is no cost for long dispersing in this situation.
Yeah.
So you disperse the farther that you disperse, the better result you get.
Exactly, that's the right answer. So the ESS is infinitely long dispersal distance because there is no cost. You go somewhere else, the habitat is as good as it was anywhere else. But the further away you go, the more you escape competition. Okay. That is shown here. This is the graph. In the x-axis we have patch size. In the y-axis we have patch quality. So it's organized in the way that, you know, it reflects that graph here. In this corner we have these landscapes. In this corner we have those landscapes. And you see that when you approach this homogeneous limit, you go like in this direction. This is how the dispersal index, like let's say the mean dispersal distance, something that relates to that, how that behaves. And you see that you are going into this direction, it's just increasing and increasing, and eventually you would get like infinite dispersal distances. Okay, so this corner is the one where you expect to see the longest dispersal distances. But how about the shortest ones? Where do you expect to see the shortest ones? This opposite case.
More sizes and
the one just on the
right. Here.
Yeah, because the chances that you will find a suitable habitat in one dispersal is close to zero.
That's right. But how about this one? I mean, if you want to stay in the patch, why?
Jump over the right place and find the patch, it's even more farther than.
Also, the patches are very small, so the distance is very high.
The smaller the patch, the more you want to disperse close.
Yeah, I think we have a combination of the right answers. I mean, one thing that nobody mentioned is that if I take this even to more extreme, so that I have even more, but you know, smaller patches, they will have less resources, of course, per patch. So then, when you do that, a single patch cannot anymore sustain a local population, it can't even sustain a local individual. So you have to move, okay? And that's why if you move to this direction, you have more movement, because eventually you have to move. You can't survive in a small resource patch. So the shortest dispersal distances evolve in this intermediate case, which is, as you guessed, looks something like this. Because in this landscape, there's really a good reason not to disperse too much. You are in a nice, big, quite big, I mean, habitat patch that can sustain a local population. You want your offspring to be also within that patch. If you disperse them further away, they just land to the matrix. Here we are asking how, for example, patch turnover rate influences dispersal. So that in the x-axis we have patch size, but it's not important now. The turnover rate means that, you know, it's the rate at which patches that are now in the landscape, they disappear and new patches appear. So you can think that this is kind of a measure of how predictable the landscape structure is. So what do you expect to happen when the landscape becomes less predictable, so that patches disappear and appear? Yeah, you expect to see more dispersal because, you know, like in this case, if the landscape is static, you evolve like very short dispersal. But if the patch might disappear and you just, you know, use that strategy, that's like an evolutionary dead end.
So the shape of the distribution of distances for each individual changes the shape of the distribution?
Well, in this case, I was assuming that the shape of the dispersal kernel is always the same. It's like, let's say, Gaussian or exponential. It doesn't really matter which you assume. But the mean of that distribution changes so that the so that the dispersal kernel in 1D can look, you know, something like this for an individual with short range dispersal, and something like this for an individual with long range dispersal. So So it always integrates to one, but here the mean dispersal distance is just larger than for that individual. This is the probability density of where the seed lands around the mother. Okay, so something that we were especially interested about was the influence of habitat loss and fragmentation. Because, you know, habitats are fragmenting, and then there is this concern of if the species can, in a more fragmented situation, anymore persist. And one part of that is if they can move between the fragments. And so there's quite a bit of evolutionary theory, I mean, examining this possibility of an evolutionary rescue effect.
This changes your ESS?
Yeah. So you apply habitat loss. You like remove some of the patches, let's say. And then, of course, the species will do worse, especially if the properties of the species stay the same. But maybe there's the possibility that, you know, evolution happens fast enough so it can adapt to the new situation. So ESS will change, and let's assume that the species achieves that new ESS, it might help it persist in the landscape. This is called the evolutionary rescue effect. And there's like contradicting literature, I mean, at least apparently contradicting literature. Some papers are saying that because of habitat fragmentation, this ESS dispersal distance will increase. Other papers are saying that it will decrease. Okay. So what this graph here is really showing that it really depends on which way you apply habitat loss and fragmentation. Because, you know, you can either remove individual habitat patches, so you decrease the patch density until you might hit an extinction threshold. Or then you can keep all of those habitats that you have, but you lower the quality. Okay, so moving here, like in the context of boreal forest conservation, moving here is that you have these remaining old growth forests, you just cut them out. Moving here is that you don't turn them into field, cultivated field, but you turn them into managed forests so that the quality gets lower from the point of view of species that have, you know, adapted to natural forests. And what you see here is that whether, you know, the ESS dispersal distance increases or decreases, it really depends in which direction you are approaching the extinction threshold. So both scenarios are possible.
What constitutes the extinction boundary?
Well, I mean, eventually when you have too little habitat remaining, whatever happens to the dispersal distance, the species cannot persist anymore in the landscape. So what these contour lines are showing, these dashed lines, is how the population density decreases when you apply habitat loss. Eventually you hit an extinction threshold, and then the species cannot persist. So, I mean, here, ESS is not defined because...
But these are all steady states, right?
Yeah.
This has nothing to do with the rate of change.
No, I'm not showing here how fast you have achieved the new ESS. I just show what is the ESS, or this ESFD in this case, but ESS would look the same. And, you know, you can do the same in a dynamic landscape. You can look at some life history variables, how they influence evolution of dispersal. But let's then move to the very final part of this paper, where we were asking how robust these predictions are to the way in which you model evolution. I mean, you can either separate the ecological and evolutionary timescales, you can do ESS, or then you can do this eco-evolutionary model to keep the coupling between those. And so what we did was to, you know, draw these kind of results for, you know, all the 12 models I described for scenarios like this, using both approaches. And mostly, I mean, the results were pretty much identical. So all the qualitative predictions were the same. There was basically only one exception where the qualitative prediction shown by this graph depended really whether we apply ESS or so that we assume that there is always a monomorphic population, ask if somebody else can invade, or if we allow the population to be polymorphic so that heritability is not one. So what we have here in the x-axis is patch size. This is when I increase patch size, then I decrease patch density, so I keep the total amount of resources constant. Well, that's not really important here. But in the y-axis, we have the patch turnover rate. So this is like how predictable the landscape is. Here it's predictable, here it's not predictable. And this is the result that we discussed earlier, that if you just increase the patch turnover rate, then this dispersal distance that evolves will become longer, because you need to move more if the landscape is less predictable. Okay. This is also what happens, you know, in this eco-evolutionary model for small patch sizes. But it doesn't happen for large patch sizes. If you have a large patches, and then you make the landscape less predictable, so that these large patches appear and disappear, then actually the mean dispersal distance in this population that evolves will go down. It will not increase as you increase the patch turnover rate. So remember that in this case, the population will always be heterogeneous. There are all kinds of individuals. So what I'm showing here is that the mean dispersal distance over all individuals, that will decrease.
Why? Because some would go extinct?
This is the question. Why? Now you take some time to think about this question, and let's see if somebody figures this out. Sorry, I can't hear.
Can you repeat the...
So the question is that usually you expect that when you increase patch turnover rate, you make the landscape less predictable, then longer dispersal distances evolve, because you have to move, because your habitat, you know, is disappearing, it moves to another place, you have to track that change. But this is telling me that if I couple this ecological and evolutionary dynamics, so that all the time I have like short individuals which are not so dispersive, individuals which are more dispersive. And there is some, you know, heritability is not one, so that you, a short moving individual can produce an individual which has a long dispersal distance, and vice versa. There is some kind of mutation or recombination rate. So in that situation, what you see that in a landscape where you have like large, high quality habitat patches, the more dynamic the landscape is, the shorter is the mean dispersal distance in the population. And we want to understand that how, why is this the case? Sorry?
Drift?
Drift? What drift?
The better chance of the, I think the large patch appears.
The patches, they disappear and appear somewhere else, or do they move?
They don't move. They disappear at random times, and then they appear into random locations.
So it should be the same as a continuous space. So it should expect very long dispersal rates, increasing dispersal rates.
What do you mean? What do you mean that it's the same as continuous space?
You have just random spots that appear anywhere else, then it doesn't matter, and you might as well disperse far away. But it's not what you
mean. Yeah, that's what you might expect. Yeah. But as said, you evolve shorter dispersal distances. That's the question. And so, to help you a little bit, I mean, let's assume that there is a large, good quality habitat patch, and we have a number of individuals there. Now I illustrate like the dispersal capacity by the size of the butterfly. So this guy is able to fly long distances. These are able to fly short distances. So I'm saying that in this corner of the parameter space where the dynamic, where the habitat is dynamic, these patches appear and disappear. I'm saying that in this corner, I mostly have these short dispersing individuals. So why is that the case?
How many times the area fit all the spaces infinite?
The space is infinite, yeah, so there's some density of habitat patches. There's no number of habitat patches.
If you're in ESS situation, so
your dispersal distance is either one, it's like binary, right? It's large or small.
Yes.
No, no. You have intermediate values in the case of TSS.
It's not the whole population all the same, but.
Everybody is the same type, yes, yeah. but it's not like everybody has like infinite dispersal distance or zero dispersal distance. They have some finite number, okay? And what I'm showing here that in the case of the ESS is such that the more dynamic is the situation, the larger is the dispersal distance that evolves, this same number for every individual.
But if you have the distribution of dispersal distances, then it's better to make sure that some stay in this patch, because if all will leave, then there is a good chance that the patch will not become extinct, turn over, but it will remain empty just because everybody left. So there is it's a good bet to make sure that some, that even a larger proportion stay or disperse short distance rather than leave.
Very good. This is the right answer. So in this kind of situation, this is like the what evolves, because you know, let's assume that this patch is surrounded by it's a long distance until the next patch. So this guy who is who's very dispersive is likely to leave the patch. You know, it's just wandering in the matrix until it dies, if you have these kind of actively moving individuals, but it's the same if you have a dispersal kernel. And so it's not contributing to the next generation, okay? Whereas these individuals which move less, they are less likely to leave the patch, so they really contribute to the next generation, okay?
But the patch doesn't disappear, like it will disappear and appear somewhere else.
Yeah, there is this dynamics that it disappears and appears again. I mean, not the same patch, but another patch disappears. And that's exactly why we need some long distance dispersing individuals, so that if a new patch appears here, you know, some of these individuals have, they all have a chance to colonize this patch, but of course this long distance dispersing individual is the most likely one to colonize that patch, okay? Now, like in the next generation in this patch, you have a lot of long distance individuals because, you know, there is some heritability. But heritability is not one, so you have also some short distance individuals. What happens in the next generation is that selection is very strong, selecting for these individuals which don't move, because the otherwise are more likely to leave the patch. So then you end up to this kind of a situation very soon, assuming that heritability is low enough. Okay, maybe this patch disappears now. We are again in a situation where we mostly had short distance individuals, and that's why this short dispersal distance is, you know, the mean dispersal distance is short, although it's very important to have also some of these very dispersive individuals. This case doesn't allow you this mixture. You have to have these individuals that disperse long distance, otherwise, you know, population goes extinct.
But this still doesn't explain why there's a decrease.
Why there is a decrease in
as,
this?
As you increase turnover, patch turnover, you see a decrease in dispersal distance. This doesn't explain, or at least I don't understand, why there is a decrease. I mean, this could as well apply to a low turnover state.
Yeah, that's actually my next question to you. That I mean, now I partly explained why even in this situation you don't, you know, need to have such very highly dispersive individuals, but you assume to have this kind of mixture, where most individuals have a low dispersal distance. But exactly, why do you decrease when you go to that direction? Why do you have shorter distances here than there?
That if you take it to the extreme, you go up to the end, then you will have each generation, you have the totally different landscape. Yeah, and then again, this is the landscape is the same, so there is no advantage to staying in a patch, because you can't stay in a patch. The patch disappears and appears somewhere else. So you should have infinite dispersal distance.
Yeah, that's a good point, that if you go far enough there, so that the landscape is varying at such a high rate that, you know, every single individual experiences all kinds of landscapes during its lifetime, then you go to the homogeneous space case, as you predicted.
Yeah.
And so there you expect to see long distances again. So if I go further up, I mean, I'll get to those long distances. But in this range, I get to shorter distances.
Okay. So
but that was a very good point. You are absolutely correct.
Okay.